So in this lesson, we've learned about two of the most commonly used methods in psychological science, correlational and experimental designs. In correlational studies, two variables are studied, such as the amount of housework and the number of sexual encounters. As it turns out, these two things were related, but remember that correlations tell us only about the strength and direction of the relationship, not whether one causes the other. In experimental studies, if done correctly, can shed light on whether one variable causes another. But true experiments have to have two conditions met. First, random assignment of participants to either a control or an experimental condition. And if these two conditions are treated exactly the same, except the experimental group gets the treatment, or the predicted cause, whereas the control group does not and serves as a baseline comparison. By giving two groups different amounts of something, we're manipulating a variable, and this leads to the second condition of an experiment. So the second condition of an experiment is manipulation of an independent variable. And an independent variable, remember, is something that the investigator manipulates. So for instance, the amount of caffeine given. An experiment also has a dependent variable, or an outcome variable. In this case, it could be reaction time. So if the amount of caffeine really does have an effect, we can say that our independent variable, or caffeine, is the cause, and the dependent variable, or reaction time, is the effect. And it depends upon the independent variable. So psychological scientists use these and many other kinds of research methods, but the key is that psychology makes use of the scientific method to answer questions about human nature, human thought, and human behavior. So psychological scientists can't do whatever they want in their research. They have to do what's ethical, and their proposals always have to be approved by an ethics board or an IRB.